All right, all, this is Dr. Alsip, and we are going to discuss our first two glands of this course, which are going to be the thyroid and parathyroid glands. I am super excited, so let's get started. So our major learning objectives for this lecture video will be to understand where the thyroid and parathyroid glands are located. Woo! Made a fancy design there. Parathyroid glands are located. Also, we're going to understand the functions of these glands. So these are endocrine glands. We'll understand what that means. And like most endocrine glands, the thyroid and parathyroid glands have a very robust vascular supply. So we will talk about which arteries will be the supply and what veins will drain. All right, so when one reflects the sternothyroid muscle, you will see the very large thyroid gland just deep to this muscle. It is located approximately between the C5 and T1 vertebral levels, and the thyroid gland is often described as butterfly shaped. So you'll have these two lobes right here and here, and one is going to be underneath this muscle, the sternothyroid, and these will be connected by a central isthmus. The thyroid gland is the largest endocrine gland. So what even is an endocrine gland? Well, it's not an exocrine gland, and we will talk about some of those in more detail when we're discussing the salivary glands. Endocrine glands are ductless, all right? So ductless, no ducts associated with these. And also importantly, they will secrete hormones. They're going to secrete hormones towards the blood, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. The hormones released by the thyroid gland will affect most areas of the body. These hormones are the thyroid hormone, which will play a role in terms of controlling the rate of metabolism, and calcitonin, which controls calcium levels. And calcium is very important in terms of strength of bone, but it's also really important in terms of muscle contraction. And so the calcitonin will reduce blood calcium levels if they are too high. So it will reduce blood calcium levels. All right, let's talk about the vascular supply. The thyroid gland is highly vascularized by two main arteries. The first will be the superior thyroid artery, which is typically that first branch of the external carotid artery. The inferior thyroid artery supplies the more inferior portions of the gland, as its name would suggest, and is a branch of the thyrocervical trunk, which is off of the first part of the subclavian artery. And we'll talk more about those divisions of the subclavian artery in the next session. The inferior thyroid artery has a very close relationship with the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And this relationship brings up a really good question. Why do we keep asking you to learn these anatomical relationships? Why does this matter? Well, let's use this relationship as an example. Note how close here, as you can see in this kind of close-up of this region, how close the inferior thyroid artery is to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So if you're performing a thyroidectomy or removal of a portion of the thyroid gland, one has to really watch where the inferior thyroid artery is ligated or tied off or closed off for surgery. Because if that recurrent laryngeal nerve, which is really close, is also injured during this process, this has tremendous implications in the function of the larynx. Because the recurrent laryngeal nerve innervates all intrinsic laryngeal muscles except the cricothyroid. It also provides afferent supply inferior to the focal bulbs. So anatomical relationships often have important clinical implications, and this one is just one of the many reasons we have you focus on these relationships so much. All right, unlike how there are two main arteries that supply the thyroid gland, there are three sets of veins that drain the thyroid. The superior thyroid vein, which is going to usually accompany fairly close with the superior thyroid artery, will drain the more superior areas, and it will drain blood directly to the internal jugular vein, typically. The middle thyroid vein It's also going to drain into the internal jugular vein, and it has a generally close relationship to the inferior thyroid artery, even though it's not quite as close as what we have with the superiors here. The inferior thyroid vein, which you can see kind of heading up in this region with numerous tributaries, is kind of a loner. It doesn't have a close relationship with either the superior or inferior thyroid arteries. This vein is usually the largest and will typically drain into the left brachiocephalic vein, although it could also drain into the right brachiocephalic vein. So it's not uncommon for it to drain into the right, but the more typical pattern is to drain into the left. So it's kind of right in this middle portion right here, kind of heading towards the isthmus region, but you can have tributaries all over this region. When performing a thyroidectomy, the posterior part of the thyroid gland is preserved if possible. This will help, of course, in protecting the important neurovasculature, but also it will preserve and protect the parathyroid glands that are typically located just in the posterior portion of the thyroid gland. It often looks like these are actually embedded within the thyroid gland, but these are very separate glands with separate functions. So you can kind of see those here in this image. The parathyroid glands are also endocrine glands. These produce or secrete parathyroid hormones, which you often hear referred to as PTH. And this is also important in terms of calcium homeostasis, along with other ions like phosphate. So calcium is big here as well, and it will actually increase blood calcium levels, which is the opposite function of calcitonin, if you recall. It's most typical to have four parathyroid glands, like you see here, a superior pair and an inferior pair. There can certainly be more or less, but the superior pair is typically the most constant in position. The parathyroid glands may be supplied by either thyroid artery, as determined by location, but typically the inferior thyroid artery is the dominant supply for the parathyroids. Now, in about 10% of people, there is a small unpaired artery that runs kind of right down this midline region associated with the trachea here, and it's branching from the brachiocephalic trunk. The possible presence of this artery must be considered when performing procedures in that midline region of the neck. So a thyroidectomy is a certain case where you need to be aware if you're working around this region, or a tracheostomy, because you can see the trachea right here. Occasionally there can be abnormal growth of the thyroid gland, which is referred to as a goiter. Goiters result most typically from a lack of iodine, or less frequently due to an autoimmune disease. Some of these are named here. You don't have to memorize these specific ones. Just they're here for example, or to kind of clarify that. Just looking at this image, you can really see how a goiter can potentially compress deeper structures or structures that are more lateral than where the thyroid gland typically extends to. So that could obstruct blood flow or cause other issues. All right, so let's think through a question together. Okay, so that thyroid ima artery that we just spoke about that's present in about 10% of people. So if there is a thyroid ima artery, it is likely to have a close relationship to which vein? Is it the inferior thyroid vein, the middle thyroid vein, or the C superior thyroid vein? And this one is a little on the trickier side. We didn't talk through this relationship, but you really have to kind of rely and think about the location of where the thyroid ima is and where these veins would be. So which ones are in a relatively similar area? Okay, so the correct answer is A, the inferior thyroid vein, which is that independent one that typically drains into the left brachiocephalic vein, or sometimes the right brachiocephalic vein, but it's kind of right in that midline region, which is where the thyroid ima would be located as well, if present. The middle thyroid vein is more closely related to the inferior thyroid artery, not the vein, while the superior thyroid vein is near the similarly named superior thyroid artery. Alright, so those are the thyroid and parathyroid glands. Make sure you understand the vascular supplies and the venous drainage as they are closely related to other structures of the neck. Thank you for all your time and attention during these videos, and I hope you have an amazing day.